Let us stand for the reading of God's word, Psalm 2. Why do the nations rage, and the people plot a vain thing? The kings of the earth set themselves, and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord and against his anointed, saying, "Let us break their bonds in pieces and cast away their cords from us." He who sits in the heavens shall laugh. The Lord shall hold them in derision. Then he shall speak to them in his wrath and distress them in his deep displeasure. Yet I have set my king on my holy hill of Zion. I will declare the decree. The Lord has said to me, "You are my son. Today I have begotten you. Ask of me, and I will give you the nations for your inheritance and the ends of the earth for your possession. You shall break them with a rod of iron. You shall dash them to pieces like a potter's vessel. Now therefore be wise, O kings. Be instructed, you judges of the earth. Serve the Lord with fear and rejoice with trembling. Kiss the Son, lest he be angry and you perish in the way when his wrath is kindled but a little. Blessed are all those who put their trust in him." Our New Testament reading comes from Acts chapter 4. We'll start with verse 23 and read through the end of the chapter. Acts chapter 4, starting with verse 23. "And being let go, they went to their own companions and reported all that the chief priests and elders had said to them. So when they heard that, they raised their voice to God with one accord and said, 'Lord, you are God, who made heaven and earth and the sea and all that is in them, who by the mouth of your servant David have said, why did the nations rage and the people plot vain things? The kings of the earth took their stand and the rulers were gathered together against the Lord and against his Christ. For truly, against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed, both Herod and Pontius Pilate with the Gentiles and the people of Israel were gathered together to do whatever your hand and your purpose determined before to be done. Now, Lord, look on their threats and grant to your servants that with all boldness they may speak your word by stretching out your hand to heal, and that signs and wonders may be done through the name of your holy servant Jesus.' And when they had prayed, the place where they were assembled together was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, and they spoke the word of God with boldness. Now the multitude of those who believed were of one heart and one soul. Neither did anyone say that any of the things he possessed was his own, but they had all things in common. And with great power, the apostles gave witness to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. Nor was there anyone among them who lacked, for all who were possessors of lands or houses sold them and brought the proceeds of the things that were sold and laid them at the apostles' feet, and they distributed to each as anyone had need. And Joses, who was also named Barnabas by the apostles, which is translated son of encouragement, a Levite of the country of Cyprus, having land, sold it and brought the money and laid it at the apostles' feet." Amen. You may be seated. We should see the book of Acts as the fulfillment of our Lord's ministry, the fulfillment of his promises, his instruction, his call that the apostles and others go into all the world. And so we think of what are some of these specific promises that Jesus gave to his disciples, to the apostles, to all who would then follow him. What are some of the promises that he gave that we see fulfilled in the book of Acts? Well, let me mention several. First, Jesus promised that he would build his church. It is Jesus who would build his church, not the disciples, not men and women. It is Jesus Christ ultimately who builds his church and has said, the gates of hell will not prevail against it. We see that the start of that fulfillment in Acts. Second, Jesus promised his presence. He promised he would be with his people as they sought to fulfill the calling that he gave to them. Jesus now also did promise or say there would be opposition. There would be harassment. There would be opposition to the truth of the gospel and the word as it was proclaimed. And yet Jesus also promised that through the Holy Spirit, he would direct his disciples in giving answer when they were called to give account at a trial. It would be the Holy Spirit who would speak in and through them. And we definitely see that fulfilled in the book of Acts. And so while we should read Acts, and ask the question, how can we learn from this? What should we be doing as a local church? That's relevant and worthwhile to ask that. We must not see Acts simply as an instruction manual, as a checklist, as a church growth plan and the like. The early church grew, they expanded, not because they followed all of the right steps, they had the right marketing. No, it was God's sovereign will that a church would be established in Jerusalem, that it would be established, that it would grow, that it would flourish, that it would spread through all the earth. It was God's grace that came so powerfully on the early church so that they did love each other, so that they carried out the mission that Jesus had given to them. So when we read the book of Acts, our first response should be to rejoice in God's power. This is a testimony of what he has done. We rejoice in his power, in his protection over his church, over his truth. You see, this is where our confidence is. Not in our own ability to duplicate everything we see in the book of Acts. If that's where we're placing our confidence, that's misguided. But if our confidence is the Lord will defend his truth, he will build his church, then there is a place for confidence, even in difficult times. And so we do humbly pray that God would use us as a local church. We humbly pray that God would continue to defend his truth. So we look at the end of Acts 4 in two parts. First, verses 23 through 31, where there is a special focus on God's power and protection, his perfect plan. Then we'll look at verses 32 through 37, where we see the grace of God, which brought unity and generosity, a meeting of real needs. So as we think of this final portion of Acts 4, we do pray that as a church, we will demonstrate boldness. We do pray that as a church, we will have true love, generosity as and for the body of Christ. So let's first look at verses 23 through 31. I want to share five main points as we look at these verses. First, we see God's power and protection over his church. God's power and protection over his church and over his truth. Now, we're almost at the end of chapter 4. We finished that today, but we know the account begins in chapter 3. The account begins with Peter and John going up to the temple at the hour of prayer, meeting a lame man who happened to be begging at the gate of the temple called Beautiful. So all of this, we can say, was never Peter and John's initial plan. This was all in the providence of God. As this lame man was healed, as it gave opportunity then for Peter to preach another powerful sermon, this time in Solomon's porch. And then, as we noted 3 weeks ago from the beginning of Acts 4, some of the priests, the captain of the temple, some of the Sadducees came upon Peter and John. We don't know if they stopped the sermon. They may well have. But they came upon them in force. They arrested them and they had them imprisoned until a trial could be called the next day. And so that next day, Peter and John stood before the most powerful religious and political body in Israel, the Sanhedrin, as it is known. I highlighted verse 13, such a beautiful verse. Now, when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived they were uneducated and untrained men, they marveled and they realized they had been with Jesus. Verse 23 records, we might say somewhat amazingly, that Peter and John were let go. We ask the question, why did they let them go? They had killed Jesus not many days before. Why did they let them go? And I don't know if we can fully answer that, except to say it is amazing to see both in Scripture and in church history, sometimes significant church leaders are released from prison. You think they could have kept them in jail. They might have helped smother that movement that had started. And so we can say this, God's ways are not always predictable. When we think of Reformation history, we think of the life of Martin Luther. Luther often thought he was going to die as a martyr. That was one of the reasons why he didn't want to get married, at least initially. He thought, I'm not going to live very long. I am under constant threat. If I leave this area, I will be arrested. I will be killed. And yet, the Lord preserved the life of Luther. He died not of martyrdom, but he died of common causes. During the English Reformation, during the years 1553 to 1558, 282 people were burned at the stake. 282 people burned at the stake, including the highest leaders in the church, Archbishop William Cranmer and others, common men and women who suffered. And we think today, how many have suffered and died, whether it's in North Korea, China, Muslim-dominated lands? How many martyrs have there been? And yet in other cases, we get testimony sometimes through Voice of the Martyrs of pastors and others who are released from prison. We just gave praise to God of a worker from the Czech Republic who was released from Sudan. So it's not something we can always predict or understand, is it? Why some die as martyrs, others are released, except we can say this. God has determined to protect his truth. God has determined he will build his church. And sometimes we see that in the release of pastors and missionaries and others. Sometimes we see it in the death of pastors and others. God always will protect his truth. Both in life and in death, he will build his church. Well, second then, we can always and we must turn to our great God in prayer. Look at verse 23. Peter and John are released from their imprisonment and they went back to the gathering. We don't know where they went, but they reported all that the chief priests and elders had said to them. So they gave a special report and update, and then immediately after that, they all began to pray. They turn immediately to prayer. I think we can say this may have been the most powerful prayer meeting of the early church. And look at the description in verse 24. When they heard that, they raised their voice to God with one accord. They all turn to prayer. They raise their voice to God with one accord. And it's interesting, we don't know who's leading this prayer meeting. No name is given. We might assume it's either Peter or John. We're not told that. Rather, the whole congregation or whoever was gathered in that specific place, they all lifted up their voice together in prayer. Even though we can say one person is leading, this is not just popcorn prayer, spontaneous prayer. No, someone is leading this prayer meeting as it is recorded here. Whoever it is that led in prayer addressed God as master of all. Now, some of our translations have the word Lord. The Greek word there is despot, or we get our word despot. It means someone who has total control and authority. Master of all, the only time that word is used of God here in the book of Acts. And look at how they come to God in prayer. You are God who made heaven and earth and the sea and all that is in them. What an awesome privilege you have in prayer. What an awesome privilege is given to us that we come before our Creator. I know this is so elementary and basic, we would say, but what a confession we have, coming before our Maker, humbling ourselves as we cry out to Him, both in praise and in petition. Now, what is noteworthy is how biblical this prayer is. Really, every word of it, we can say, comes from Scripture in large part. And that would be a very interesting study, to focus on how the apostles were shaped by the truth of Scripture, both in their prayers and in all their sermons. James Boyce wrote this: "When God's people worship, they always do two things. One, they pray, and two, they reflect on the Scriptures." Prayer is our talking to God. The Scriptures are God's talking to us. And the two always go together. You pray in a right way when you pray scripturally. You study the Scriptures in a right way when you study prayerfully. This is what the early church was doing. They had been reflecting on the Scriptures. Again, we see here the teaching of Jesus. As He opened the eyes of the disciples, of the apostles, they understood the Old Testament Scriptures in light of the Lord Jesus Christ. Here the apostles, again, they're following the instruction of Jesus. Here the apostles applied Psalm 2. And who are they applying it to? They're applying it, we might say, in a special way, to the rebellious leaders of Israel, the Sanhedrin, the ones who were seeking to stop the spread of the word, who were giving threats, seeking to silence the disciples. So what the kings of the earth were doing in Psalm 2, the people plotting vain things, that's what the Sanhedrin was doing. They had gathered against Jesus. Now they were gathering against the disciples. Now, ultimately, when we study the book of Psalms, we see the fulfillment of them in Christ. It is Jesus who is the true fulfillment of Psalm 2. And yet in the New Testament, and this is an interesting thing, we have to be careful in understanding it, but we can say this: we are called to share in the sufferings of Christ. We share in the sufferings of Christ. Now, we have to be very careful. The sufferings of Christ on the cross are finished. His atonement, that is finished. But the sufferings of Christ now continue, we can say, in the sufferings of His people. And so the apostles are understanding this. They understand that Christ is the fulfillment of the Psalms, but they also now, as His people, they are called to share in His sufferings. Now, we also note, in particular in verse 27, the apostles understood historically the death of Jesus. And notice how they call attention to all the parties who conspired together. You have Herod and Pontius Pilate. You have the Gentiles or the Romans. And you have the people of Israel that were all gathered together. And the verb "gathered together" is also then used in verse 26. It's the word, the same verb used in the Septuagint, the Greek translation of Psalm 2 and verse 2. Now, why do I highlight this? Well, sometimes there is misunderstanding about who is responsible for the death of Jesus. Who is responsible for the death of Jesus? Well, this passage gives answer to that. Historically, we can say it is Herod, Pontius Pilate, the Romans, and the people of Israel. All of these different groups, these different people, were all historically responsible for the death of Jesus Christ. In this sense, you and I were not historically responsible for the death of Jesus. Now, theologically, we speak of why Jesus died. And He died then as the atonement for the sins of God's people. Theologically, we are the cause, we can say, as our sin was placed upon Christ as he paid the penalty which only he could pay in bringing atonement for us. So we do have to understand historically and theologically, the two are not in tension with each other, but they're not identical in terms of what we have revealed here. Now third, let's look at verse 28. Verse 28 gives us a very powerful statement of the sovereignty of God, his eternal plan. Notice that verse. They, the four that are listed in verse 27, they were gathered together. Now notice, to do whatever your hand and your purpose determined before to be done. Isn't that a powerful statement? Because Psalm 2 speaks of the nations wanting to do their own plans, and they attempted such. And yet in their rebellion, in their conspiracy, what are they ultimately doing? Ultimately, they are doing what God's plan has determined. Ultimately, they are fulfilling the power and will of God. So notice there's reference to God's hand, that is his power. There's reference to God's purpose, his will. And then notice the verb translated determined before. Determined before to be done. That particular verb is used 6 times in the New Testament. In Romans and in Ephesians, it's translated as predestined. It means something that is determined before, boundaries that are determined before. So in Romans 8:29, we read, "For whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, whom he predestined, these he also called. Whom he called, these he also justified. Whom he justified, these he also glorified." Herod, Pontius Pilate, the Gentiles, the people of Israel carried out what God had predestined would be done. So I say it's a very powerful statement about the plan of God, his will. So God did not merely look into the future and forecast what would happen. No, he has a plan. We speak of the eternal plan of God in the singular often, a plan that includes every single thing. Now, that's way more than we can fully grasp, that God has a plan that includes every single thing that happens. And yet Scripture also asserts men are responsible before God. And yet God's hand and his plan encompasses everything. There's no tension there when we properly understand these things. There's no tension between truth. We can't fully understand it. Yet we say it's the clear teaching of Scripture. That's one thing we must say. This is what God's word teaches. That's why we believe it. But also we can say this. It is the basis for assurance and comfort. We don't just accept it. Well, it's in there. We have to take it. No, this is part of our comfort and assurance. If you've been reading some of the Table Talk devotionals recently, they've been speaking about God's sovereignty, and they made a very good point. If God was not sovereign, if he did not have a plan, how could we trust in any of his promises? How would we know God could fulfill them unless he had a perfect plan that would be fulfilled in every single detail? As I say, this must humble us before God. And yet it is also our confidence as we come before him. Well, fourth, note the specific request of the apostles and the others that were gathered. They pray for God to take notice of the threats. They pray that God would grant boldness. He would show his power to heal and to demonstrate signs and wonders through the name of Jesus. In verse 17, we read that the Sanhedrin severely threatened Peter and John. We can only understand they threatened them with death, with pain and with death, a severe threat. And so they come before the Lord. Look at the threats that have been made against us. And in Acts 9 and verse 1, we read of Saul before he's converted, Saul still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord. Several weeks ago, we observed this is one of Satan's key weapons, trying to silence the truth. Satan uses threat. He wants to scare us. Now, how do we overcome threats? How do we overcome the threats of the world? Well, I think the answer given here is boldness. It is God-given boldness that overcomes the threats. And so boldness is one of the key words of this chapter. We noted it already from verse 13. They saw the boldness of Peter and John. Here they pray for boldness. And in verse 31, we read, they spoke the word of God with boldness. And that is still a very appropriate prayer that you should often pray. Lord, give me boldness so that I'm not silent. Give me boldness so that I am not filled with fear about what others will think. Give boldness to speak your word. They also then pray that God would stretch out his hand and heal. The grammar here is interesting, but verse 30, God, stretch out your hand to heal. The same word heal in verse 30 is used in verse 22, referring to the miracle of the lame man who was healed. Why did the apostles pray this way? Well, they recognized when God showed his power in the healing of this lame man that it brought great opportunity for the preaching of the word. It was the healing that gave opportunity then for Peter to preach to that crowd who gathered, wondering what had taken place. That's why they pray for God to show his power. It's not that they just want all these cool things happening. No, they're looking for opportunity for the preaching of the word, for God to show his power. Now, we don't live in the same apostolic age. As we see in the book of Acts, the foundation of the church has been laid. Christ is the chief cornerstone. The apostles then are part of that foundation. So I don't think we pray in the same way. We understand, no, God does work in different ways, in the sense of the foundation has already been laid. I think we still, though, appropriately pray that God will show his power so that the faithful preaching of the word can be given. John Calvin said this, the more we perceive ourselves to be helped by the Lord, let us learn to crave at the hands of God that we may go forward hereafter. When we see God answer prayer, what should that encourage you to do? To want to pray even more. We should crave that. And then especially seeing the free confession of the gospel is a singular gift of God. We must continually beseech him to keep us in the same. We pray that we will maintain a faithful witness to the truth. And that is an amazing thing that still shows the power of God today. And I think if we look carefully, we can say, you know what? God has preserved his truth in this age. Oh, our nation is such a mess, my friends. We know that. And yet, look at the assault on the truth of God's word in this nation for well over 100 years. The hatred for the book of Genesis. The hatred for the gospel. Look at how many churches since the 1920s and before have totally gone apostate. I think it is an amazing thing. There is still a remnant. I don't know how large it is. There is still a remnant that loves the word of God. There is still the faithful preaching of God's word. We might say, oh, I wish churches were doing more. I wish churches were more faithful. And we're right to feel that way. And yet, my friends, let's step back and consider. Even in our own apostate nation, God has preserved, he has guarded his truth. He has shown his power in so doing. Yes, we don't live in the same age as the book of Acts, but my friends, I assure you, God is still at work today, and we pray this will continue. Well, God granted at that particular prayer meeting, God granted a very powerful sign of his presence and answer to prayer. Look at verse 31. We read, the place where they were gathered was shaken, and that wasn't the drum set. That was the power and presence of God, the Holy Spirit, we can say. And so God granted a sign. Again, we don't see that in our own prayer meetings, at least not the ones I've attended. God gave, we might say, a special sign. Why? Because there was incredible threat against the truth. Here the threat is, if you continue to preach the word of God, we will murder you. I'm sure that caused a certain amount of fear and uncertainty. And so God grants to the church, at least to those that were gathered them. No, he gives them a special sign. I am with you. The gates of hell will not prevail against the church. And so they are again filled with the Holy Spirit. Not for the first time, but they are renewed by the Holy Spirit's power. And then what do they do after this prayer meeting? We see they spoke the word of God with boldness. They did not give in to fear. They did not give in to threat. They went out, the apostles, and perhaps we can say others. God answered prayer, and they spoke the word of God with boldness. Well, secondly, let's look at the final part of this chapter, verses 32 through 37. Here we consider three points from these final verses. First, we see the amazing unity, the generosity, and the sharing demonstrated by the believers in Jerusalem. Look at verse 32. It speaks of the multitude of those who believed. And that's significant. There are many who are coming now to saving faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. The multitude, not just of the church, but of those who believed. Acts 5:14 says, believers were increasingly added to the Lord, multitudes of both men and women. And based on what we understand in the book of Acts, there were thousands and thousands of believers at this point. The multitude of those who believed, and yet they are of one heart and one soul. I think heart and soul are used together not to emphasize two separate things, but to emphasize, no, the true unity that was enjoyed. They were many. There's a multitude, and yet there is oneness. There's oneness in heart and soul. We can say further, they were not selfish, but they held things in common. And we noted this adjective translated as common. It comes from the Greek adjective koina, to have things in common. It's related to the noun koinonia, which is often translated as fellowship or communion. I defined communion or fellowship as that unity that we have in Christ. That's the basis of fellowship. It's the unity that we have in Christ that leads to us then coming together to work together, to give, to seek the advancement of the gospel. And what makes the unity of the early church so wonderful is it was not a forced unity. Notice that. It's not that they are all joining a commune, and the terms of the commune are this: sell everything you have and give it to the apostles. This is not forced unity. We can say it is a grace-generated, Holy Spirit-given unity. Dennis Johnson wrote this: Acts points to a more difficult form of financial fellowship, which probes our motives and never lets us shift responsibility to others. The concepts of enforcement and compliance don't fit into Luke's portrait, for the generosity he extols is prompted not by external coercion or peer pressure, but by the inner compulsion of grateful love. This focus on heart attitude has its dangers, to be sure. Hypocrisy, pride, and a pinched and calculating spirit are constant threats. Compassion can be counterfeited, either in a bold-faced lie, such as Ananias and Sapphira's, or in the subtle self-deception that talks faith and love, but turns a closed heart toward needy sisters and brothers. Look at verse 33. Verse 33 says, and great grace was upon them all. Great grace was upon them all. And I think that sentence speaks of what's before it It speaks of the apostles giving witness to the resurrection. It also speaks of what follows, this incredible unity and generosity and sacrifice. The grace of God was upon them. And as we think of grace, we must first think of it in relationship to the message of salvation. God's grace to us in Christ. We know the love, the favor of God only in Christ, or especially in Christ. But then grace is also the response. The response to what we enjoy in Christ. Verse 34 says, none lacked. That's an amazing thing. You have now thousands and thousands of believers living in a very hostile city. This is not an easy place for believers to live. Why did none lack? Well, the answer is because those who were able to sold their houses, they sold their lands. After they sold them, they brought the proceeds of those sales and gave them to the apostles. And we see this was entirely voluntary. We'll note this more in Acts 5, but look at Acts 5 and verse 4. Peter, speaking to Ananias, said, while it remained, that is, while you had this land, was it not your own? After it was sold, was it not in your own control? Ananias, when you had that land, it was entirely yours. After you sold that land, Ananias, you didn't have to give the money. So all of this is entirely voluntary. And what is significant is the New Testament speaks of meeting true needs. The needs that were there in Jerusalem, we can say, were real. It's not people who were lazy, who are moving in to live off the church. No, they were real needs. And yet, later, Paul also speaks, he met his own needs. The same word is used in Acts 20, 34. Paul says, you yourselves know these hands have provided for my necessities and for those who are with me. So the New Testament speaks of incredible generosity and sacrifice and sharing, but it also says personal responsibility. Let him who stole steal no more. Let him labor with his hands. So we can say socialism, government-sponsored socialism, is wicked because it is an attempt to pervert and stop Christian love and grace. And that is why it is a wicked thing, because it's a perversion of God's grace. But at the same time, my friends, unity and generosity, it's a beautiful thing. Beautiful description that's given here. And yet these things, they are demanding, right? It is much easier to speak of them, to praise them, than to do them. And that is why John says, let's not just love in word and deed, or word only, but in deed also. And so we recognize the grace of God, and only as you recognize the grace of God can you then do what you are called to do in terms of this same spirit of generosity. We'll look again also at verse 33. In the midst of this focus on this love and unity, there is still an important witness that is given in verse 33. And we read, with great power, the apostles gave witness to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. We can't ignore that. Again, many Christians emphasize we need love, we need compassion. That is all true. And yet, we also see the early church proclaim the historic truth. I know this is nothing new, but we see, again, many attempts to either diminish, to confuse what Jesus Christ accomplished on the cross, both today and in the past, and that is most wicked and damnable. The apostles gave witness to the resurrection. Well, third and finally here, we have the example of Barnabas. Look at the final two verses of Acts chapter 4. In the midst of talking in general, Luke gives us a specific example. This one, neither named Joseph or Joses, but who was given the name Barnabas. Now, in Hebrew and in Aramaic, Bar means son. He's called son of encouragement. It's not entirely clear how that comes from the novice part, but we don't have to worry about that. The apostles named this man because he was an encouraging man, a son of encouragement, one who gives encouragement to others. And that's what we see in the life of Barnabas. I think that's why he's mentioned here, both because of his generosity and then because of what we see in the rest of the book of Acts. He plays one of the most important parts of the book of Acts. Remember how when we looked at the listing of the apostles in Acts 1, we noted we don't know really anything about most of those apostles. And yet we do know quite a bit about this one, Barnabas. He is an encourager, and the Lord used him in a mighty way. It was Barnabas. Let me just share 5 points about Barnabas. First, it was Barnabas who brought Saul, or Paul, to the apostles after Paul's conversion, when people were still very suspicious and afraid of Paul. If you want to follow along, you can turn to Acts 9 and verse 27. Acts 9 and verse 27, we read this, "But Barnabas took him," that is Saul, "and brought him to the apostles, and he declared to them how he," that is Paul, "had seen the Lord on the road, and that he had spoken to him, and how he had preached boldly at Damascus in the name of Jesus." It's through Barnabas that Saul or Paul is introduced to the other apostles and given a seal that this is legitimate. You don't need to be afraid of Saul anymore. Second, and this comes from Acts 11, Barnabas is sent by the church in Jerusalem, so he must have served for a time in Jerusalem. And the leaders in Jerusalem sent Barnabas to Antioch to see the spread of the gospel and then encourage new believers in Antioch. Acts 11 and verse 23, we read this, "When he," that is Barnabas, "came and had seen the grace of God, he was glad and encouraged them all that with purpose of heart, they should continue with the Lord." You see, the encouragement that Barnabas brought was not, "Oh, you're doing a great job." I'm sure he was a nice person. But true encouragement is encouragement to stand fast in the Lord. That's the encouragement that Barnabas brought. Third, then it's Barnabas who recruits Saul to come back or to come to Antioch and be part of the work that was going on in Antioch. Look at Acts 11, verse 25. "Then Barnabas departed for Tarsus to seek Saul. And when he had found him, he brought him to Antioch. So it was that for a whole year, they assembled with the church and taught a great many people, and the disciples were first called Christians in Antioch." We can say this, in part through Barnabas, we are called Christians. Significant ministry. Then fourth, this is now Acts 13. Paul, or Saul still, and Barnabas are set apart by the Holy Spirit. Saul and Barnabas are set apart by the Holy Spirit. Look at Acts 13, 2. "As they ministered to the Lord and fasted, the Holy Spirit said, 'Now separate to me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called them.' Then having fasted and prayed and laid hands on them, they sent them away." What we call Paul's first missionary journey. The first missionary journey of Saul and Barnabas. Now, Paul, or Saul, would continue to minister with Barnabas until they came to a point of conflict. Do you remember that point of conflict? John Mark had been part of that first missionary journey, and for some reason, John Mark wimped out. At least Paul thought so. John Mark had to leave the mission. And so when Barnabas and Paul were determined to go and visit those churches where they had first been, we read this in Acts 15, 39. "Then the contention became so sharp that they parted from one another, and so Barnabas took Mark and sailed to Cyprus. But Paul chose Silas and departed, being commended by the brethren to the grace of God." Paul and Barnabas separated over John Mark, whether he was fit for another mission. And we read, the contention became so sharp, the disagreement so intense that they separate. It's a sad testimony. Now, who's right in this matter? We're not told. Now, later we do read of Paul acknowledging that Mark was useful for ministry. I don't know that means, well, Barnabas was in the right, Paul was in the wrong. Sometimes those even who love each other and want to work together, sometimes we unfortunately come to disagreements. This is the last time that Barnabas is mentioned in Acts. He's mentioned in Corinthians and Galatians, but this is the last thing we know of his ministry. A very important ministry played by Barnabas, one who is generous with his money and who is mightily used by the Lord to encourage and build up the church of Jesus Christ. My friends, 2 points to conclude. We live, no doubt, in an age of despair. But when I read the scriptures, when I read the book of Acts, I'm given confidence, even in an age of despair. Because here's 2 things I know. God loves his truth. He loves his truth, and he loves his church. And when God loves his truth, he will preserve and guard his truth. When he loves his church, he will shepherd and guard his church through all seasons. And so, yes, we can be discouraged about many, many things in this day, but let's not be filled with despair. I don't know how God is going to build his church and his kingdom. I don't have prophecies that I can give, but I have assurance. And that is why we continue to speak the truth, even when others do not want to listen, because it doesn't depend on us. It doesn't depend on our own witness, but our witness results from the fact that we know the Lord Jesus Christ is still at work. So, my friends, let's not grow weary in doing the work that we have been called to do. Second, let me again have us highlight the power of prayer that we find here in the book of Acts. This incredible prayer meeting. As I was talking in chapel about a month or two ago, I mentioned the testimony of Charles Spurgeon and the congregation, the Metropolitan Tabernacle, that he pastored for many, many years. And the story is of visitors who often came to visit the church. And one time 2 visitors came. They didn't know who Spurgeon was by face. And Spurgeon met them, and he told them, this was in July, do you want to come and see the heating or the furnace of this church? And they thought, that's a little strange. It's July. So he took them down into the basement there of the Metropolitan Tabernacle, and there were hundreds of people in prayer before the service. Spurgeon said, this is how this church is heated. It's heated by prayer. Now, as we think of weekly prayer meetings, I know there are issues in that. I would love that more of us could come on Wednesdays, could come to this particular place, but I would plead with you, if you cannot join with us, can you still pray? Maybe it's not going to be on a Wednesday, but maybe you can take another night, another time for prayer, serious prayer. Again, we have to be motivated not by, oh, I think this is what I need to do because others will think better or worse of me if I'm there or not. That's not the motive. The motive is we know prayer is part of the fuel for the mission that we are given to do. We pray in a sense out of duty, but we pray because that's the delight. That's a glorious duty. So if you can't join with us for Wednesday prayer, and I understand there's distance, there's other things, can you set apart time still for prayer? Praying even for the same needs. I can send you the prayer sheet. You can take the bulletin. It's much the same. But we need to be in serious prayer as a church if we are going to withstand these hostile and difficult days. It will only be because we are devoted to prayer. So my friends, leave knowing the power but also the delight of prayer. And then we see again this sacrificial spirit that we pray the Lord will continue to grant among us. A spirit of seeking first his kingdom. I can say this small little church If we've had any success, if we've had any blessing, it is because the Lord has given to us a sacrificial spirit among many. Some who have gone already to their eternal reward, others who are still by God's grace with us. There's been a sacrificial spirit, and we pray the Lord will continue that. Not so our names can go in places, not so that we can be known, but because that's also part of the duty and delight. I think the Lord has granted a certain measure of that. And let us pray as God's grace works in all of our lives that that will continue. For his glory and honor, we pray. And let us close in prayer now, please. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the direction we find in your word, the conviction. Oh Lord, where we are lacking individually, where we are lacking as a congregation, make that clear to us. Perhaps we are negligent in prayer, in other matters. Oh Lord, we want to encourage each other in the truth of your word. And I thank you for those in this congregation who demonstrate that encouraging spirit to me and I trust to others and build up that spirit of encouragement among us. We all need that. And Lord, give that sacrificial, generous spirit that will allow the ministry of the gospel, that will allow some of the educational ministries here to continue. And again, thank you for those that you have used in significant ways. But among all of us, whether we have much or little, may we have that spirit of love and unity we need according to your grace, not human wisdom, not human programs, your grace in and among us. We ask all of this so that your name may be given glory, your truth may be faithfully proclaimed. In Jesus' name, we all say, amen.